So this week's top eight really was kind of a top eight we'd had earmarked for the season-ending top eight.
Yeah, we had such a good show queued up for last week.
And then we just didn't have the technology for it. Everything was on its way to Denver. But here we have our top eight cards of 2014. And I should really kind of drill down a little bit here because we had a lot of discussion defining exactly what we're talking about here. It's the top eight cards printed in 2014. Okay, so top eight.
But not printed necessarily for the first time. Just they were printed at some point in
2014. So first off, we have a few honorable mentions. Fetchlands. Fetchlands were an honorable mention. You know, obviously they're amazing, very, very good. It was great to see him back. Really great to see him back, maybe more for modern and legacy formats than standard formats.
Yeah.
But still, honorable mention, great to see him back. And then, of course, Paul, I'd be remiss if I didn't bring this up. He was really pushing for this honorable mention. I think you agreed too, Raptor. God's End, yes. God's End definitely gets an honorable mention for 2014, card printed in 2014. Any honorable mentions for you guys?
Yeah, for me, it's absolutely Black Lotus, which was printed on Magic Online.
Printed?
Printed. He's talking about Moto,
released,
not me.
released on Magic Online.
Fine. Released in 2014 on Magic Online, sure.
Yeah, so it brought vintage onto Magic Online, which has been awesome. It's been like a huge thing for it.
Amazing effects. Vintage Super League has opened up playing so many, you know, I mean, Martell, you may not love vintage, but you certainly started playing a lot more vintage.
There's
just so many more people who play vintage and Magic now because you can just play online.
It's so much
whenever.
More accessible. Yeah. Right. Yeah. The only other two cards that came out that aren't on the list that I thought might be worth mentioning, Council's Judgment, which actually, you know, came out and was an answer to True Name, and then Containment Priest, although I'm not sure if that quite had the effect that...
Not quite yet.
But more judgment than anything.
I would say, I mean, for me, there's an honorable mention. I mean, I think some of the... Eidolon of Blossoms came out in 2014 and as the Doomway Giant. Mm-hmm. And I'd say there's that pair. Just give them an honorable shout-out here.
Yeah.
As they've certainly had a lot of impact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I think those two... We'll keep seeing them, I think, going forward.
Also, on the website right now, shameless plug for the video, but it is fun, is Dak Faden. Luis won 5 flips in a row. I don't know if you guys saw this on this Cube video. He won 5. He went ultimate with Dak Faden and won 5-point flips.
That's Ralzarek.
Ralzarek. Sorry. I always get them confused. They're the same color. My fault.
They are the same color.
Ralzarek, too long ago. Sorry, buddy. All right. Top 8 list. Coming in at number 8, Mana Confluence. You just swapped this into a GP deck.
Yeah.
So tell us about Mana Confluence.
Sure. I mean, it's the reprint of City of the Brass. Obviously... We've been kind of starred for mana fixing for aggressive decks for a while. It's been hard to build multicolor aggressive decks, and because all the fixing has come into play tapped with like things like temples. So this card really hit a sweet spot with what you needed in those decks. It's probably, I think, had a little bit less of a splash or an impact than maybe some of us expected. The life loss is just pretty painful in this current format.
Well, also, pain lands have come out since then.
Making which toned it down a little bit.
Which made Mana Confluence less important. Like, when it first came out, it was just... The go-to mana fixer for so many two-color decks, not even like multicolor ones. So
and now, ironically, because I'm so used to a world where we have allied pain lands and not enemy pain lands, now we have enemy pain lands with allied ones. So you're still forcing.
Yeah, this is enemy pain land still.
Yeah,
right.
It's the allied pain land now.
Or allied.
You look at like the red green deck lists and pull up Lucas's list here. Has plays 1 Mana Confluence, Kibler's playing 2.
Yeah,
like it is filling that slot. So it still sees play there.
Coming in at number 7, this was a card that, to be honest, at first I thought it was great. I didn't think it was great. I think we did a preview on this together, Raptor, on a previous Magic TV, and it was tough to say. And now, obviously, an amazing card, Goblin Rabble Master. Thoughts on Goblin Rabble Master, Raptor?
Yeah, this is coming to be like the Red's marquee 3-drop.
Sure.
In a world of like good 3-drops, this is Red's like equivalent of Cursor in terms of how good it is in the decks that play it.
Thoughts on Rabble Master there, Martell?
I think it's probably not as good as the common consensus is for it. Like, I think that people play it in spots where it doesn't quite reach its full potential. But I mean, yeah, left unchecked, it wins the game so quickly. Mm-hmm. And it's forced the format to warp around it. So maybe in the current format, it's very hostile because there is so many cards like Bioblight running around. But without this card, you wouldn't need to be playing as many copies. So because it ends the game so fast and so punishing, people have to really overhedge against it. So it certainly had a huge impact.
It's definitely the card, you know, staring at a turn 3 Goblin Rabble Master so many times means you've just lost.
Yep.
And so
yep.
Anytime you have a card like that, that kind of impact, it's going to be good.
Yep.
Speaking of course, it's
a card that just, when everything else is equal and they have that and you have nothing, it just kills you immediately.
Yeah,
like,
game over.
No other card can accomplish that in Standard in terms of just how rapidly you can die to it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we just mentioned Courser, and it comes in at number 6, Courser of Crucifix. Of course, with the standard rotation, this was the card, particularly after the Pro Tour, that everyone said, okay, this is going to be the best card in standard. Courser of Crucifix is just going to be the best thing out there. And of course, number 6, so still doing well, but well, not necessarily.
If we were ranking cards in standard, it might still, you know, be closer to number 1 here.
But Courser, great card, and you still see plenty of it everywhere you look.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it certainly did not turn out to be the menace that it was feared to be. Mm-hmm. But it's still, yeah, an incredibly dominant card and extremely powerful.
In standard, at least, they printed cards that could interact with it favorably, whereas in block, there just wasn't, right? In block, right. It blocked everything. And all the games are still in grindy, so like the land ability was really relevant. Whereas in standard, there's ways to go over the top of it, ways to go around it. Like it still has an impact. And certainly, you look at like Abs and Mirrors, it's certainly an important card, but it's not the kind of the brick wall that it was in block.
Yeah, it's still the card alongside Carry Tidbits, constraining what you can actually play in the format.
Sure.
Because you have to, your creatures just have to be able to attack through those. Creatures that don't are just so much worse than ones that do.
Well, and even our discussions now with future cards like Floor's Defiance, you know, Courser is one of the cards on the list. Of course, when we talk about main decking things like Erase or Destructive Revelry,
Courser's the card that lets you get away with that.
You're kind of saying, well, at worst, I'm taking out a Courser.
I would say Courser, though, is the card that lets you get away with it, not the reason why you want to.
Agreed.
Which is a distinction from the block form. It was you wanted to kill the Coursers.
Yeah. Like,
that's a subtle change. And it is surprising. I mean, everyone thought the pair of Carrington Coursers would be so great. Carrington's not even that good right now, actually, because the format shifted so much to address it.
Yep.
You know, you boarded out in half your matchups in the Carrington decks. A lot of us moved to Abs at midrange because we didn't want to play with Carrington. It's not very good right now. So I think it's an interesting shift. And the fact that Coursers will weather that and still stay you know, pretty near the top is impressive and shows how powerful the card is.
Well, coming in at number 5, we mentioned Goblin Rabble Master, and one of the cards it interacts with amazingly is Stoke the Flames. And this was a card I can just tell you, I mean, it seemed like half the year we just couldn't keep in stock. It was like sold out at $1, sold out at $2, sold out at $3, sold out at $4. Finally, I think we have it at $5, and it's still like a card that's consistently selling. Pretty crazy, you know, in the aggro deck, it just starts coming over the top. It's definitely made its mark on standard. What do you think of Stoke the Flames?
I mean, the card is just ridiculous. I mean, being able to burn something out for no mana functionally, you play multiple things on a critical turn, is huge. 4 damage, obviously a lot of damage as well. Being able to kill cards like Courser that we're talking about is just really impactful. So it's powerful on all axes that you'd want out of a burn spell, and fits into so many decks. And its partnership with Rabble Master is obviously huge.
Right.
You don't have to throw your token. Make the token, tap it, the Rabble Master, and 2 lands. 4 damage for 2 mana is just busted.
This is the card that powers up Rabble Master so much.
Right.
And Hordling Outburst. Like, that also just synergizes perfectly with it. Just
0 mana.
Go on turn 4, like, make 3 power worth of guys and, you know, kill something with a Stoke of the Flames is super powerful.
Reminiscent for me of Fire Blast. You know, I'm it's not as good as Fire Blast, but definitely playing it better.
Yeah.
No way.
Fire Blast wouldn't be remotely playable in standard right now. And Stoke the Flames is one of the best cards.
Well, there's no one plays Mountains.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's only because you're playing like 2 and 3 color decks. Fire Blast is a sweet card. Don't listen to Raptor. He has no idea what he's talking about.
You're not seeing Stoke the Flames in Legacy yet.
I'll admit that Stoke the Flames is worse than Fire Blast in formats where Fire Blast is actually legal.
Actually legal. Okay, fair. Coming in at number 4, a very popular and controversial card, or a card that brought controversy at least this year, Hornet Queen. What do you guys think of Hornet Queen?
It is the go-to high-end. If you want a finisher, this is the best possible one you can have.
It's crazy because it was a card, again, when we did our M15 preview, it looked like it had possibilities, but it wasn't something that just kind of jumped out at you, I didn't think. But
If you played Block Constructed, it jumped out to you.
Yeah. This was, by far, we thought that would be the dominant card at the Pro Tour for standard. I mean, our first month of testing and mailing around emails on deck lists on the list were all built around who gets to win Hornet Queen Mirrors. Every list had 4. Obviously, as cards emerged, like cards like Doomite Giant that could fight against it in a profitable way, it took a little bit more of a backseat. It wasn't as oppressive as we thought it might be. But, I mean, 6 power of flyers, all spread out over 5 creatures, making spot removal irrelevant, having death touch. I mean, everything about this card is just insane.
This is the card that keeps Abzan midrange in check. This card single-handedly beats that deck, and if this card doesn't exist, I think that's, you know, just the best deck to play.
Well, great. Coming in at number three, another less expensive but nonetheless quite large creature that has certainly made its impact not only in Standard but Modern, Siege Rhino. Well, I mean, what hasn't been said about Siege Rhino?
This card is bonkers. I mean, yeah. I don't understand how it's a 4/5.
Yeah, it's just like, I mean, you know.
Can I just say I hate Siege Rhino?
Yeah, who doesn't?
I just can never beat it. It's just a stupid big creature.
What? You're the one who's always playing Jeskai.
Yeah, and I can just never beat it.
No, this is why you don't win.
This is why Valoris Vines is like his top pick.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Finally, I can actually
beat a Siege Rhino now.
Yeah, it's just too good. I mean, you look at all other versions of this, right? I mean, compare this card to like Locks on a Hierarch, compare this card. Every version's been very good in Standard, right? Mm-hmm. Ravenous Baloth was one of the dominant cards in that format.
Sure.
Locks on a Hierarch was a dominant card in that format. Mm-hmm. Every version's card is Thrag Tusk was a dominant card in its format. And then this is probably the best out of all of them. Maybe Thrag Tusk, you could argue, is a little bit better. I don't think so.
Thrag Tusk was better in its format than Siege Rhino is in this one, but yeah. Siege Rhino's the better card.
Right. Yeah, I mean, this format isn't dominated by Vapor Snags and whatnot, right. So yeah. I think part of what made Thrag Tusk so good. But they just took all these cards have been great in their formats and then just made it drain them as well for three. Like,
that's what's unbelievable.
And gave another point of toughness.
4/5, trample, drain you for three, kill you.
I thought it was a 4/5 that gained you three left. They go, that card's great. You get to do three. Yeah, the card's absurd.
So good. I mean, it instantly saw Modern play, right?
Yes.
It not only did it see Modern play, it shifted Pod from this like combo type deck to let's just play pure value creatures because
well,
we have
I think that
value.
That shift that wanted to anyway. Happen anyway. Yeah. Like the Pod had already been going that way. I think it was more like Delver being a top deck that mm-hmm. shifted it further. Like that was just not a deck that you want.
You don't even see combo anymore though, do you?
Because right, the metagame has moved, not because of Siege Rhino's existence.
Okay. I mean, Siege Rhino's existence helps. Like having that card, which you want anyway, definitely lets you play just the value game even better than before, but certainly more everything else changing around Pod that makes it want to go that direction also.
Well, they have number three, Siege Rhino. Number two, Raptor, this is going to be all you. Your favorite card in ages, Jeskai Ascendancy.
Yeah, Siege Rhino may have won the battle in Standard, but I think this card is the one that wins out in Modern. Though that hasn't necessarily...
And Legacy.
That hasn't necessarily played itself out yet, but I'll still take Ascendancy over Siege Rhino.
Well, Ascendancy certainly has won the battle in your heart. So.
Absolutely.
We don't have any cause there. Now, we spent a lot of time talking about this card in Modern more than anything. You know, was it going to get banned? How was it going to go? And then, of course, you came up with changing it from Mana Creature to Fate Stitcher at Champs. Do you think Jeskai Ascendancy is still on its way up?
Yeah, I think it's almost certainly getting banned still.
Yeah.
I agree. I'm trying to find last-minute flights to Omaha this weekend so I can play it with it one more time.
Booked a last-minute flight for exactly that reason, yeah.
Just found one? I should talk to you. I can't find anything reasonable.
Wow. So look for Ascendancy in Omaha, I guess. At least one of you and possibly both of you playing it, huh? Really, you think it's going to get banned in Modern?
Yeah.
Well, you heard it.
Even if it doesn't, they'll ban... Some other cards, which we'll talk about in a moment. Yeah. And then the deck is, without those, the deck doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Well, so get together, go to Omaha, and play your Ascendancy while you can. Of course, the number one card, really cards, because we couldn't kind of make the cut, are the Delve cards coming in. We have Treasury.
Hooting Mandrills and Necropolis Fiend. Yeah, our favorite.
Exactly.
Everyone's favorite. I mean, we had Tombstalker, now we have Necropolis Fiend. It's just an improvement.
It's unbelievable. No, we have Dig Through Time, we have Treasure Cruise, and frankly, Murderous Cut. Murderous Cut's pretty sweet card.
Yeah.
That one's also transitioned to older formats just fine, too.
Yeah. Delve is just, anytime you're kind of back-ending cheating that mana acceleration for an amazing effect, and Delve is obviously...
Well, anytime you're tapping one land and drawing three cards.
or going seven deep and...
Or double impulsing for two, yeah.
Right, or just killing any creature you want. It's pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
Should Delve cards be number one on this list because of Standard or because of
They're certainly not number one for Standard. If we're talking Standard only, Siege Rhino or Cursor, like those have to be the top two, right?
No, I think Rhino's further down, but I think Siege Rhino's number one, and I think being Cursor's probably still the top eight, but it's not that high. I think
it's probably number two. Like,
agree to disagree.
But in terms of overall impact in the game of Magic across formats, these Delve cards, I mean, they're everywhere. An instant impact, right?
Yeah, these cards have just completely, like, reshaken the landscape of every format outside of Standard.
Well, there you guys have. Any last thoughts on the cards of 2014 that have seen print?
Yeah, I think it's a good summary. I mean, the Delve cards, just to reiterate, I mean, if you look at Vintage, right? If you look at the evolution of VSL deck lists, mm-hmm. I think we started with, like, maybe four Gushes and three Cruises, and it was, like, three Gushes and four Cruises, then we're, like, one Gush, four Cruises, two Digs. I mean, it just, you're just seeing them run rampant. You can't overstate how powerful these cards are.
They are insane, particularly these eternal formats where it's just, I mean, there is no alternate casting cost. It's just one mana or two mana or whatever you want. There you have it, our top eight cards printed in 2014. For you, Raptor, I will remind everyone of our honorable mention. Black Lotus. Raptor is a huge champion, and it has changed the online format and made Vintage much more accessible. So honorable mention one more time, Black Lotus on Magic Online. But the actual top eight, number eight, Mana Confluence. Number seven, Goblin Rabble Master. Number six, Courser of Krufix. Number five, Stoke the Flames. Number four, Hornet Queen. Coming in number three, Siege Rhino. Number two, once again for you, Raptor, Jeskai Ascendancy. And coming in at number one, sharing the top spot, the Delve cards, Treasure Cruise, Dig Through Time, and Murderous Cut. That does it for us tonight on Magic TV. Thanks a lot for watching. Thanks for coming out, guys. Yep. You know, in between GPs for one, if not both of you. Welcome back home ever so shortly. And of course, coming up this month, we got a lot of Pro Tour testing, a lot of extra players in town. So we'll have to see if we can get them in for some top eights and some Magic TVs.
We could probably fill this whole studio.
Oh, we probably could. I mean, we're gonna have the whole team is going to be here, except for Luis. Ironically, right?
Luis. Yeah, it was like, Luis.
I'm not gonna make it, you know, he's too busy juggling around.
So no top eight vaults just yet.
No top eight vaults. Yeah.
We can do top eight rooms. Room escape.
You guys in this escape room. If you haven't been following these guys on Facebook, it's all about the room escape. Although you failed in one, didn't you?
Twice.
Oh, you failed in twice. Yeah. Both of them. I'd just like to point out that my team did both of those same rooms and succeeded in both of them.
That's true. You had a superior room team.
Well, there you have it, guys. Thanks for tuning in this week. I'm Mashi Scanlon. With me, Josh Utter-Leyton at Raptor, and Tom Martell at Tom Martell. We'll see you guys next week. Take care. Have a great week.